Welcome to Cinema Talk with Mike Mixtape, the segment of which I interview video producers, whether it's with reviews, content of humor, and etc. This third interview, of course, is the build-up you guys have all been waiting for ever since I did James and Morgan. It's Matt Brunet, also known as Animat, the man behind the animation look back, his Animat reviews, and so much more. Welcome, Matt.
Hey, guys. So, Mike, how's it going?
Good. Good. How about you?
Oh, so far it's doing nice. I just finished up, almost finished up doing a bit of renovations around my place. And so far it's going really nice, and I'm hoping that this could lead to a pretty good upgrade on my videos, at least.
Good, 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 good. So what I do here on this segment show is I just casually talk with the video producer about various topics, so with your life, past, present, until future, so whatever. The first two questions I normally ask, which I did with James and Morgan, is first one being, what was the earliest memory that you can think of when it comes to film? What was the first movie you've seen?
The first movie I've seen? Oh, God. That is a good question. I mean, like, I know that I've had a lot of movies in my childhood, mm-hmm. but... I don't recall what would be, like, the first one ever. Like, I could probably just list you a few of the childhood films I've seen, like, whether it be either Alice in Wonderland or The Three Caballeros. That's another favorite of mine. What else would there be? Actually, some people would find it weird. Two of them would actually include Thumbelina and A Troll in Central Park. And but I know that there is also another one, which is the Bugs Bunny and Roadrunner movie. Hmm. And even though, yes, there was also Space Jam that I discovered, the Looney Tunes, and like it pretty much grew from there. But like my proper introduction to the Looney Tunes, to fully know who they are, is pretty much the Bugs Bunny and Roadrunner movie, which is technically a good thing because Most of the shorts in there consist of the best Looney Tunes shorts. So, at least I'm pretty much satisfied to know that I grew up with the best.
Good, good, good. Okay, this is the question that I even got asked in college for my film art classes. What is the film that got you into movies?
That got me into movies?
That got you interested in the movies, like, when it comes to, like, production, animation, you know, everything behind the scenes, you know, like, the full force of movies in general.
Well, you know, interestingly enough, I don't know which one specifically. If there's, like, a specific film in which that really got me hooked into, knowing more about movies, really getting interested in films... But, I would have to answer, it's just how I pretty much grew up, because, like, as a child, when I was watching all those VHSs, often I remember I would have my mom and dad to read out the credits, because with early Disney films, they often start out with the credits, and, like, they would have to read us the names and stuff like that, like, who did what and all that kind of stuff. Well, they didn't mention which part of the film, like who's the animator and stuff like that. They only mentioned the names. But that, and also when DVDs came along, I remember me and my family were highly interested in the behind the scenes stuff. And most often than not, we would equally watch the bonus features on those DVDs about the making of those films as much as the movie itself. So I guess I kind of grew upon learning a lot of the behind the scenes aspects, learning about what they do, what is it that in the process of making it made the film so unique? What was the touch that it had that would make it stand out from all the other films? So yeah, like a long answer short, I would have to say I don't really have one specifically, but it's just how I grew up. It's mostly the fascination of learning all the behind-the-scenes stuff about movies.
Cool. Did films in general lead up to like going to college for film, in general, or did how did that when it comes to education wise?
Well, education-wise, it was actually very interesting because it was actually a pretty long and difficult path because originally I thought about being an animator myself. So, like, I had to find several paths, and originally, like, I wanted to like apply in animation at in college, but it didn't work out as well. So, like, I decided to take a bit of a detour and decided to start a bit more broad. And I went into fine arts in college. So I am actually a fine art graduate. So I did a bit of that, and I tried applying onto university to go to animation, like to go a bit higher, now that I did get my college degree for animation. But unfortunately, that actually did not work out as well. So instead, I decided to settle what I have here. So technically, I do have an education, but it's not into animation. It's not on film history. It's not on. It doesn't have to do with film. It's actually onto fine arts. So, technically, in an educational point of view, I am technically more of an artist than I am of a filmmaker, which I actually do have. Like I have a lot of proof in which like I am an artist because I've done a lot of different stuff. I've done like it's not just drawing. I've done a lot of paintings. I did a lot of prints. I did a lot of sculptures. I put them all up on DeviantArt to show like some of the examples I've done. But yeah, like I like what fine arts pretty much helped me is to really expand my horizons of my capabilities as an artist.
Cool. That's very interesting to know, because both James and Morgan did the same that sort of thing. They went through film and stuff, so interesting to hear that from your point of view. How what was the beginnings of Animation Look Back? How did that all start?
Well, interestingly enough, it was back when I recently discovered James Rolfe and the Angry Video Game Nerd, and I was, and I was starting to really get into it and really fascinated. And originally, I thought about having my own online web show, but based on video games. But back then, I really wanted to be like James Rolfe. And I thought about maybe having my main show be about video games, and then on the side project, I do some sort of like Cinemassacre Monster Madness kind of show, but except I talk about the movies I like. And then it dawned upon me that like I wanted to do like I think it was the second Cinemassacre Monster Madness, like either the first one on all the classic horror films or the Godzilla-thon. I looked at it and I thought like, how about I make like some sort of Cinemassacre Monster Madness, but I want to talk about Disney films, all the movies and the bibliography of Animation Look Back of not Animation Look Back, but I mean like the entire filmography of Walt Disney Animation Studios. So I decided that like I knew that if I wanted to do the video game show, it would require a lot more equipment with cameras and all that kind of stuff. And I knew that doing that cinema like doing the Disney project would be a lot simpler. It would just be me on a microphone just talking about the Disney stuff, and like it would require a lot less resource, a lot less equipment. So one summer I decided to go and fully do that and start on that project, and I guess it ended up growing from there.
So, was James Rolfe and Doug Walker the big influences on you as you were building your content?
Absolutely. I would definitely say so. James Rolfe mainly, and then later down the line, I discovered Doug Walker, aka the Nostalgia Critic, and then like that's where it really grew upon there. And I think like with the aspect of Doug and the Nostalgia Critic, it helped me try to find an identity because that was back during the whole prime of the website That Guy with the Glasses. And I also decided, like, while I was making Animation Look Back, like when I started doing that, I decided to also do reviews on the side and decided to test the waters and did my first review with a movie that was recently released at the time, The Princess and the Frog. And in front, like, while I was building myself up from there, like when 2010 rolled along, that's when I started to go and find my own identity to, you know, like, because back then the big goal for any reviewer was to be a part of That Guy with the Glasses. It was kind of like the Hollywood of internet reviewers. If you can make it there, you can make it anywhere. So that's when I pretty much decided to build myself upon, like, trying to, I guess the best way to put it is build myself up as a character, kind of be an internet personality. And that's where I ended up forming and becoming Animat. Like, even before then, like, actually, the funny thing is, Animat didn't even come in until a little bit later in 2010. Like, because before then, like, it wasn't Animat's reviews or stuff like that. It was just Matt's reviews. In fact, like, if you look at, like, my first top 10 I've ever done, the top 10 Disney sidekicks, like, I didn't introduce myself as Animat. It was just Matt, and it was, like, an entirely different costume than it was before. It wouldn't be until it wouldn't be until a little bit later when I fully formed myself as Animat. And funny enough, like, my most popular video that I've ever done, the top 10 scariest Disney moments, was the full-on introduction to Animat with the orange fedora, the yellow dragon t-shirt, and yeah, that's pretty much how I formed it. So in terms of Doug Walker, he was an absolute influence, but not necessarily in terms of my videos, but more of my identity as an internet personality.
Right, cool. Yeah, everybody's been on that point. I mean, we all started on the forums way back when, and it's just...
Oh, yeah.
Now the forums are just not what they used to be. It's like everybody moved on beyond that ever since
they changed. Well, Channel Awesome really wasn't as it used to be. Like everything about that fully changed.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, no, like, nowadays, like, I've talked with a lot of other reviewers. Like, recently I went to Con Bravo, and I've talked, like, with other internet personalities, and there was a once upon a time when, like, the big dream was to be a part of that, of, like, That Guy with Glasses or Channel Awesome. But nowadays, it's not really that much of a necessity. And even when I look back, like, I would contemplate, do I really need to be a part of Channel Awesome? Like, even to this day, if Rob Walker would actually ask me to join the website, like, I would definitely say yes, hands down. But it's not like a need, you know? It's not like I build upon all this to be a part of That Guy with the Glasses to help myself gain more popularity. And that's actually another thing. Like, if I do join the website, would I necessarily gain anything? And that, like, that's the thing. And, like, I'm very proud of myself with how I've built my, you know, with how I've built upon my channel, and things are going extremely well with it. But, you know, like, nowadays I just look upon the Channel Awesome website. It would be a nice addition, but it's not an absolute necessity to join the website.
Yeah. So, when creating Animat, what were the key elements of Animat? What went into the costume? What was with the fedora? What were the elements that created Animat as a character?
Well, funny enough, like, I never really thought of Animat as a character. Like, in a way, I just wanted to do me in front of the camera. Like, because I kind of thought to myself, like, I don't have to create a character, kind of like what Doug Walker did with the Nostalgia Critic, or what James Rolfe did with the Angry Video Game Nerd. Like, you know, I felt like I myself was more of a unique and wacky character more than anything else that I could think of. So I thought about, you know, just building myself upon that. And as for the whole costume and the whole gear, I just thought about what I thought would look cool, actually. Like, because it was back then when I was really heavy upon wearing fedoras all the time. And I always, like, the orange hat was probably my favorite one, so I decided to take that. And I think it was, like, that the dragon shirt was brand new, so I decided to wear it at the same time, and then also have the blue undershirt kind of complement the orange. So I guess like that's how I pretty much formed the costume. But yeah, overall, it just like I would say that Animat is mostly me. So that's mostly the answer, is that like maybe it is a bit more of a more exaggerated, a more like presentable kind of me in a way, because you know how it is, like no matter what the situation could be, like people are always different when they're on camera or off camera, but it's like a more, like I would say Animat is like me but with more pizzazz in a way.
And that's what most online personalities are. They're just like an elevated a person of you. It's just like you try to, because you're not going to be like such a downer. You're going to be peppy a lot when it comes to doing these mm-hmm. videos. And that's what most people are doing. They're just doing an elevated version of themselves.
Yeah, like you got to put in like high energy all the time on it. Like when you're on there, you can't just be like lowbrow and casual and stuff like that. It's just, you know, it doesn't necessarily fit, so that's why you got to level it up a bit.
Exactly. Growing up with animation, I'm just trying to think. What, I know one of your favorites is Fantasia.
Mm-hmm.
Is there an animated film besides Fantasia that you highly recommend that novice animation people should look into?
Oh, absolutely, yeah, absolutely. Like, even though, yeah, Fantasia is my favorite, but I've also done, like, my big top 10, like, Disney films that I love. And, of course, like, in terms of the Disney ones, like, you also got many of the other classics, rather it be Snow White, Pinocchio, Beauty and the Beast, Little Mermaid, Aladdin, The Lion King, and even some of the more recent ones, like Frozen, Tangled, Wreck-It Ralph, Zootopia. But at the same time, like from other studios as well, it's also great to look upon. For Studio Ghibli, I mean, the collection of Hayao Miyazaki is absolutely phenomenal, from Spirited Away, Castle in the Sky, The Wind Rises. There's also like the Pixar collection as well is also a great way to start, rather it be the Toy Story trilogy, The Incredibles, Finding Nemo, Inside Out. For DreamWorks, like, there are a few selected ones, but some of my highly recommended ones, rather, like, it could be, like, the first two Shrek films, some of the first ones, like Prince of Egypt, El Dorado, the Kung Fu Panda movies, absolutely. The second How to Train Your Dragon film is absolutely wonderful. I'm actually just going, like, listing through the DVD collection that I have all around me, but there are plenty of other great ones as well. I'm trying to think, like some of the stop-motion films, Nightmare Before Christmas, Fantastic Mr. Fox. Recently, there was Kubo and the Two Strings. That was wonderful. Some of the works of Don Bluth, The Secret of Nim, An American Tale, All Dogs Go to Heaven, The Land Before Time. Some of the underrated ones, like The Adventures of Tintin, Batman, Mask of the Phantasm, especially, and also like independent films, Waltz with Bashir, Secret of Kells, Song of the Sea, Yellow Submarine, Watership Down. There's like a wide variety. I mean, if you do a bit of your research, you can check out which are the great ones that you can find. And often you'll find that, like, whenever you would find list of best animated films, there are some that you'll find that's repeated over and over, like Pinocchio, Spirited Away is going to be a very common one. And like even some of the Pixar films like Toy Story or The Incredibles. So yeah, like it's very easy to start off which animated film, like which are the best animated films to start off, but there is such a wide variety that you can go into.
Yeah, because as many people who watch my channel, I'm not the hugest animation fan. I mean, I grew up with it, but I kind of faded out of it. So I'm trying to get back into it, and that's why I wanted to know. So just as a...
Yeah, like, you can pretty much start off with the big ones from, like, my recommendation, just start off with Disney and Pixar, and then, like, you can expand from there.
How was it growing up with animation that got you into animation, or what was the key element that got you into animation the most?
No, it was absolutely growing up with animation. It actually did start out, like, when I was a kid, of course, like, I would watch cartoons and animation because I was a kid. But when I entered upon my teen years, that's when I began becoming a huge Disney fan. So it did, like, my fandom didn't necessarily start out fully into animation, but it started out with Disney. It wasn't until when I started making my videos with Animation Look Back and Animats Reviews when I started to grow upon the other elements from animation. That's when I started to discover more of the other companies like DreamWorks and Studio Ghibli and Blue Sky and all the others. So that, like, it kind of grew, like, I guess it just started out, like, with one base where I was a huge Disney fan, and I still am today, and then it kind of just blossomed from there.
Yeah, that makes sense. Makes sense. I was just... Do you have any plans for your 7th anniversary on YouTube?
Oh my god.
That's coming up. It's coming up next week Sunday as we're recording this.
Oh my god, it's on Sunday. That is true. 7 years. Honestly, no, not really. I'm just going to continue with what I have now. I mean, like, technically, if I am celebrating my 7th anniversary, it's just upgrading my place. I don't know if you... For those of you watching, I don't know if you may notice, but things are a little bit different than how they are beforehand. So I am getting some new, a few new pieces of equipment that I'm hoping to upgrade. So I guess that could be a way to celebrate. But I'm not planning anything too big for the 7th anniversary. But yeah, it's just mostly that. Maybe I'll just mention a tweet or something. But yeah, just like... my videos turning 7 isn't necessary, or like my whole channel is not necessarily big, so I'm just gonna keep it natural, keep it casual, and just keep working and doing what I do.
That's something I noticed on your channel, so I just wanted, just being curious about that. How did you meet Stefan Ellison, Mr. Coat? How did you get incorporated with Mr. Coat and Friends?
Oh, with the Mr. Coat website. Interestingly enough, it actually began, like, this was all the way back when I started. It was in the middle of when I was working on Animation Look Back, like when I started out with the first one with Disney. It wasn't Stefan, it was actually Logan Reithenbaugh, aka Huey Two More. He was the one who discovered it, and, like, he was just immediately in love with those videos. I was like, oh my god, those videos are so cool, they were awesome. Like, hey, there's this new website that I joined in, I wouldn't say new, but the website was relatively fresh. But like, hey, I'll ask him if you want to join in. And funny enough, Stefan actually said yes, and I pretty much remained a member of Mr. Cove from there. So that's pretty much how I grew upon it, and then afterwards I guess the rest would be history when I would meet some of the other members, including James and Morgan, Dan, Mike, and all the others.
How did you first meet James Sullivan and Morgan Ledger?
That is honestly a very good question, because, like, I've been good friends with them for so long now that I don't, like, oh my god, it's honestly faded in my memory that it's just, like, I guess nowadays I kind of accept the fact that these guys are my buds. I kind of forgot about the origins, but I guess, like, if I would have to make a guess, actually, I think it actually all began when I was doing, like, beforehand there was this show called Fantasy Movie Memories. It was a series that Logan and Morgan wanted to do, and Logan brought me in to be the narrator. And from there, like, that basically it was a huge project at the time that involved many of the members from Mr. Coat, and Morgan was one of the writers, so I guess I met him from there. And James was doing some of the research as well. He was also involved with the project in some way, and I guess maybe that's where I met the guys. I don't know. Or either that, or maybe Logan introduced me to them just casually to know, like, kind of a warm-up party to be a part of Mr. Cove, but that's pretty much it.
Yeah, I talked exclusively with Morgan with Fantasy Movie Memories, and that was a big mess of a project.
Oh God, yeah. I mean the behind the scenes story that went with that, my God.
God, yeah,
That was a
he explained the
mess.
whole thing to me. He was like telling his side of the story and all that, and it was
Oh yeah.
one of his big controversies back in the day, with Logan. I mean, is there anything between like Logan and you guys? It's like it seems like you guys have like a love-hate relationship with Logan in a way.
Oh boy, this is gonna be difficult to talk about because chances are he could be watching this. No, but oh boy, the thing is with Logan is that he does have a bit of a reputation that he is a bit difficult to work with. On the count of that, he is very demanding. I remember when I was recording episodes for Fantasy Movie Memories, like it was not easy. Because like under his direction, like he really wanted it that I have to say it in this way, I have to pronounce it correctly in that way, like he pretty much has to make sure that everything is right, and it really wasn't easy. And on top of that, I remember there was at one point when I was like way back in my beginnings when I actually worked with him on an episode of Huey's Animated Movie Reviews, and I did the Scary Godmother episode. And in that sense, I remember like it took like hours upon hours. It took a lot longer than it should just to write it. It was ridiculous. I remember I spent like maybe 6 hours on Skype just to do the writing. It was ridiculous. But yeah, I guess that's kind of the whole thing is that Logan does have a bit of a reputation that he's not the easiest reviewer to work with.
Sorry, Logan.
If you want, Mike, you can just edit that out just in case.
I'm just kidding. No, I always it was really unloaded with Morgan because he just went right into the all the everything about Logan and the fantasy movie memory, so it was
Oh yeah, I mean like yeah, with Morgan, like he ha I know for a fact. I haven't seen the interview, but I know for a fact that he has such a whale of a tale to explain about that whole mess with his relationship with Logan and the whole controversy with Fantasy Movie Memories. It was ridiculous.
Yeah, it was quite interesting to hear all that in a nutshell. So, this is the well, actually, before I get into that, what was the project, the video that you're most proud of?
That I'm most proud of. Honestly, that is a good question because like I might have a few. Of course, like my first one ever, Animation Lookback, not Looney Tunes, sorry. Animation Lookback, Walt Disney Animation Studios, like the first one ever because I literally started out with nothing. I knew zero about making videos and stuff like that, and I just hopped on the editing software and just go from there. So like that is one that I'm proud of. I would say actually like in terms of my reviews, the like so far my favorite one that I have ever done is actually the Escape from Tomorrow review. That one somehow I felt like all the jokes are done correctly, my criticisms are very on point. I mean the movie is absolutely messed up and it's trying to be so provocative and like solely dependent on this simple novelty of, oh, we filmed at Disney World without Disney's permission, but the writing is absolutely broken. Whoever was in charge of it, like Randy Moore, the guy who directed, wrote, and produced it, like you could clearly tell the dude doesn't know how to make movies in general, and like it really came out as such a messed up film. But also, the one thing that I'm really glad about is that. I also wrote, like, it was the first time I actually wrote my own song for it. Like I did a parody of One Little Spark called Journey into Ignoring Escape from Tomorrow, and it like overall it came out as a phenomenal review. Like I was really proud of that. But nowadays I would have to say that it's now a repetitive theme that usually my most recent videos would be my proudest, like because I always aim to be better, to make myself better and better and better. And as of this interview, I would say the one that I am the proudest so far is the newest animation look back I've done, Animation Look Back Looney Tunes, or the history of Looney Tunes Animation Look Back. And with that one, I pretty much made sure that all the facts are done correctly, everything is presented well. I worked very hard to get that, like pretty much that entire homage to the Bugs Bunny and Roadrunner movie to get it right. So overall, I'm really proud of that. So yeah, that would be my answer.
It truly shows. Your work is very pristine and perfect, and you know how to make videos right over the years.
Like that's one of the secrets about like making videos or making. Pretty much crafting your own art. That's the secret of being a true artist or being a great filmmaker and stuff, is that you gotta learn to make yourself better than what you were before.
Exactly. We'll try that. So, is y should I say, is YouTube the full-time job? Do you work making videos as a living?
I wouldn't necessarily say as a living per se, but I do work on YouTube full time. Like I am putting my entire focus on that to build upon it to be larger and larger, to the point that like I absolutely would like to have it so that I can make some good money on it. So basically I am at the point that yes, I am doing it full time. But like I am trying to focus on trying to build my empire, to really build it, to make it bigger and bigger, to make my brand more legitimate, and to really make some good money out of it as well.
Yeah, so it's not just a hobby, it's just it's more like a.
Oh no, it's mostly like yes, it is a job, but it's a job that I absolutely love. Like and it's absolutely perfect, like this is something that I love doing and I make money out of it. So, you get the best of both worlds.
Exactly. So this is the part of the interview where I talk about the whole process of you becoming on my podcast and some key moments from the podcast and all that stuff. So,
Now we're going into the Cinema Royale part.
yes, the Cinema Royale part of it. I know Morgan was the big key of getting all you guys together for my podcast. I actually thanked him for doing it because he was the big key of it. Morgan kind of convinced James and you. He's like, because he was the link between you and James, and I was like, I gotta have you two on the podcast, and just it was a unique process of doing that. And the first episode we'd done, the unofficial one we'd done, was a pilot we did in 2012 in December when we did Star Wars.
Oh, that is true.
It not only had us, but it had Star, aka Sarah, on it as well. And I was trying to record that, and Skype back then was horrible for me, so I was trying to record it, and all of a sudden I get go in and out, and it's like, did you guys talk about this? Yep, we talked about this. I'm like, I didn't record it, so it's just like I couldn't compile it together. So I was like, screw it, we'll do a pilot in January 2013, and we started from there and just had a good time with it until now. I wouldn't say, I know you don't watch it because you experienced Cinema Royale, but what was.
Oh, technically I did. I was in it.
Exactly. You experienced it. You didn't have to.
I don't have to watch it again. I've already seen it. I've already experienced it.
Yeah, so I was just gonna say, what.
I don't need to watch old home videos of me talking on Skype.
Exactly. What are your favorite moments of Cinema Royale?
Wow. That is actually a pretty good question, but I honestly don't know really. I'm not usually the kind of guy that would folk like that would often remember like specific moments per se, but honestly, like a good highlight of mine, I remember it was the one that we talked about, the Muppet movies. That was
Oh.
actually one that was a lot of fun to do. Oh my God. And I remember like it came like what actually came out of it was pretty much the infamous joke of the butt's ass, where like I remember I was just so full of rage talking about I think it was Letters to Santa, A Muppet's Christmas, because that is hands down the worst thing that ever has the Muppet name on it. It was absolutely terrible. And I remember I was just I was just so angry at it because like of how bad it is, down to the point I guess I raged to where like I don't even connect my brain with my mouth, and somehow butt's ass came out of it. So I guess that would be that's probably my highlight episode.
Yeah, that is. That was the Muppets one was a big one, and since you were the biggest Muppet fan of besides outside of Morgan, because you two have
No,
are
no, no,
big
no, no,
Muppets
no.
fans.
More, I would, I'd still give the title to Morgan, but, I'm still doing what I can do to be a Muppet fan. Like, every week I do the Muppet vlogs, so at least that's my little contribution there.
How did you get introduced to the Muppets? What was the first Muppet thing you've
Oh my
seen?
God. Oh, that was, I remember it was as a child, I saw this VHS of the Muppet Show. And it was just like a short compilation clip mixing in different little skits from like the season 2 and season 3 and season 4. So it was just mixing all that up. And I remember I would just rewatch that over and over. And then from there, like I would also get a few other VHSs of the Muppets. And I guess like another big element would be when I would go to Disney World, like my favorite ride, and it still is today, is Muppet Vision 3D. So I guess from there, like it really grew. So like I grew up with the Muppets ever since the very beginning, and like still a huge Muppet fan today.
Do you like any other Jim Henson works besides the main Muppets?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Like The Dark Crystal is a fantastic movie. That is actually absolutely wonderful. Other Jim Henson stuff though. Well, like when you do think about it, like he doesn't really have a lot. I mean, like of course I grew up with Sesame Street. That's a
Right,
given.
that's a given.
That yeah, that's like a default for any child.
Exactly.
But other than that, that is actually a pretty good question. I don't know. Like I guess it's mostly the Muppets, Sesame Street, and the Dark Crystal. Like I didn't watch a lot of Fraggle Rock. Not a huge, honestly, not a huge fan of Labyrinth, which I might get scolded for that. But yeah, like well, when you do think about it, Jim didn't do a lot of stuff actually. Like any projects that are like really big, like a massive TV show that Jim Henson is involved with, or a movie, Like his main elements are mostly the Muppets and Sesame Street and just like doing special effects and stuff.
Yeah, the one that most people kind of forget about, don't talk about a lot about, is dinosaurs.
Oh yeah, dinosaurs. Like I remember I think I watched some episodes as a kid, but I don't think it was the kind of show that really stuck into my memory that I remember watching a lot. I don't really remember what happened in the show, so.
It was one of my favorites actually as a kid. So it was the Sesame Street, of course, and then there was a couple of Muppet things, and it was kind of weird because I watched a couple things as a kid, but then when we did the Muppets episode, I was completely silent. I didn't talk a lot. There's a few things, but you guys just ran the whole show because I didn't know much about Muppets. So.
Well, we owned the whole thing. I mean, it was our time to shine.
It was your time to shine. It was kind of cool and lasted in a two-parter. Jesus Christ, full of. That's what you get for doing a full retrospective of the Muppets. God.
Well, yeah, I mean, and that was just the movies. I don't think we even touched upon the TV shows.
No, we didn't even do that, but that's some good stuff.
Dude, that's some good stuff, bruh.
One of the
Dude, you gotta try this, man. You gotta try this Muppet.
one of the biggest running gags on the podcast that I
The
kind
running gays? How far do these gays run?
one of the key
That
running
is one hell of a Pride Month, I gotta say.
One of the key running gags on the podcast that I kind of started with you was the whole premise of Debbie.
Oh, Debbie, yes.
Oh, episode 28, when we talked about sequels, and I mentioned Debbie Does Dallas and all the sequels, and from there, it just was born into this like running gag on the podcast. Every time we do a podcast, Debbie gets brought up for whatever reason, and it's like you're kind of a like imaginary mistress or girlfriend in the background.
Always in the back, ready for me.
Just it was the best things ever, and I don't know how was your reaction to Debbie? I mean, how's that every time we do a podcast, huh?
It's just a lot of fun, you know. It's just like, like as the guy who grew up also doing, I was also taught to do improv. Like, I always learned to just go with the flow, and it's always a lot of fun. Just I don't know, in a way, just giving, like, I guess giving me this image that, like, there's always, like, someone waiting for me, like, just ready for sex. It's like, yeah, sure, why not? Like, it's a position that, like, many guys would like to be in. Just like, okay, I gotta do this work, then afterwards we jump and have some fun.
And the thing is with Cinema Royale is that this shows your audience the whole other side of Matt, the after dark Matt, because.
Oh yeah, the dark, yeah, like it's kind of like I guess the best way to put it is that it's like Cartoon Network, where usually, like, when you go on my channel, you got all the Cartoon Network stuff. When you go to Cinema Royale, you suddenly enter upon Adult Swim.
Yes, that's a good analogy. That's a really good analogy. Never thought about that. Oh yeah, so that's just great to hear. Sometimes you slip a swear instead of your catchphrases. I was just like, "Whoa, Matt."
Well, yeah, I mean, like, it does happen. Like, sometimes, like, for the purpose of a joke, like, I remember there was one I did, it was the, oh, I think, like, I remember there's this one gag that I wanted to do. It's with Sa I don't know how it happened, but it's like, what if Samuel Jackson was actually Oz? Like, he is the Wizard of Oz, and just end off going from there and, like, try to be more accurate with the joke. Like, why not just slip in a few swears?
Yeah.
Like, I know I am very well known to not necessarily swear as much as other reviewers, like the Nostalgia Critic or Cinema Snob, but, like, even in real life, I don't really swear a lot. But often, I don't know what it is. Like, sometimes, like, I can let a few of them slip out of it. But I don't know. Maybe I felt like Cinema Ro you know, I guess with Cinema Royale, it's more of a casual thing, Like, it's not just a podcast, but it's also like kind of a hangout for us to just
Exactly.
chillax and have fun. So
Exactly.
I guess, like, from there, I guess some of the swears would come out of it, but it's mostly for gag purposes. Like, you don't necessarily hear me legitimately swear saying, like, how bad a movie is or something like that. You know what I mean?
So, your alternative swears on your Cartoon Network channel. Is like what the fridge and
Yeah.
Fudge Nabbit. So it's just like, is that something you coined, like doing on your channel? Just like I would just patent that and just put it on a t-shirt, just like just to market it out, you know? Just.
Oh, not actually, no. The thing is, it's not just on my videos. It's not like I actually go WTF in real life. No, that is something that is legitimately me. Like, keep in mind, like we stated before, Animat is like an elevated version of me. So, when I would say things like Fudge Nabbit or What the Fridge, it's something that I legitimately say. Like, I would often go around, like, I would legit go around saying, "What the fridge?" or "Fudge Nabbit." It's like, it's even very well known within my family. So it's a pretty common thing.
Thinking about it now, there's more about how'd you get into anime in particular? Because I
In
know,
an what?
is it just Studio Ghibli films in general, or how did you get into anime?
How I got into anime, it's actually very interesting because I'm not like full on weeaboo major anime fan.
Exactly.
Like I mostly focus on Western animation. That's mostly the big focus. Usually it's like like animated features coming from big studios like Disney or Pixar or whatever. But I guess like in terms of anime, like there are a few things that I grew up with. Mostly like as a kid, I always watched Pokemon, Digimon, and Yu-Gi-Oh, but I never fully got into the anime stuff. Like sure, I watch a lot of the Studio Ghibli films, but when you're an animation fan, that's kind of like pretty essential that you have to check out. But recently, what I would do in terms of anime is that I would often get Patreon requests, and it actually began this year when I started out reviewing Holic, and then it kind of grew from there when I would get other requests as well, including what was it? Like I also got Death Note. Like that was one that I reviewed, and that was actually an amazing anime. And then what happened afterwards is that I actually do have a few more upcoming reviews that are actually Patreon requested animes. So I am currently working on that. So I'm not necessarily fully into anime, but there are some things that I get into. Like for me, anime is just like, the fourth genre of animation where you got hand drawn, computer, stop motion, and then you got anime, which because of the huge fan base and kind of like the approach to it is far different than most of the others. Like technically it would count as hand drawn, but it pretty much became its own thing in general.
Yeah, I know you kind of review any kind of animation, internationally. I know you've reviewed like I said, anime, and I think you've reviewed like British films in the past, and
Oh yeah. Like I've done like many different reviews from around the world. Like I did The Secret of Kells, which is from Ireland. I do the Aardman films, of course, from England. In fact, like I did a lot of British films. It's not just Aardman, but I also did Animal Farm and I did Watership Down. There's also a Middle Eastern animated film that I've done. Absolutely beautiful. Waltz with Bashir. Honestly, highly underrated. Absolutely fantastic. Honestly, other films that I've seen from around the world, I mean, yeah, like of course I did Japan since I did Studio Ghibli as well. I don't know. From any other countries? Well, I am planning, like, hopefully one day I will make it to where I would review a French animated film. Like, rather it be like Triplets of Belleville, the 2010 Illusionist, or something like that. That would be nice. But, like, well, technically, you could argue that considering some animated films are made around the world, like the Illumination movies, like Despicable Me or The Secret Life of Pets, some of the production was actually done in France. Or even, like, when you. And actually, there are even some movies that are made in my hometown in Montreal, where The Little Prince, for example, some of the production was done in Paris, but a lot of the other elements are actually made in Montreal. Like, once the main elements of animation is complete in France, they would move on to Montreal to do some of the extra parts, like the lighting and the special effects and a few other stuff.
What decided for you to open the P.O. box?
The P.O. Box. Oh, the P.O. Box. Yeah, with what's in the box. Honestly, it started out as a Patreon reward on like if I made it to $250 a month, I would open up a P.O. box so people could send me letters and packages. And I decided to start it off from there. And, you know, it started off relatively small, but then it essentially picked up into the point that it became bigger and bigger, and people just kept on sending me letters, and like these are actual written letters, and even a lot of packages as well. I end up getting so many things from it. Many of the, like, some of the DVDs and Blu-rays that I actually got are actually fan donated, which I am very grateful for. And the funny thing with what's in the box is that this is actually a show, even though it's not necessarily my most popular series that I've done, it's not as popular as like Animation Lookback or Animax Reviews. Mm-hmm. It's a show that's pretty much it's pretty much, in a way, it's a show for fans by fans, because the fans are the ones that actually fuel the show, and they would be the ones who would send me all the packages, they would send me the letters. In fact, considering that, like, we are recording this on my birthday, on October, which is the month of my birthday, what I have coming up, like, there's going to be a lot of packages. Just a little heads up there.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. By the way, happy birthday.
Yeah, thanks, dude. But, yeah, like, that's basically the whole thing with What's in the Box. It is a show that is done for fans, mm-hmm. by fans. Like, they're the ones who run the show, basically. Yeah. It's not really about me. It's
right. Yeah, more it is. It is, and your fan base is growing. Like, I'm surprised it's growing really, I mean, I shouldn't say I'm not surprised, but it's just like it's growing very big. Like right now, as this interview is, you are at 55,023 subscribers. That is like, you're like, out of the group of us, you're the most popular one. You're just like, you have the most subscribers, you got all the views, and it's just, you're climbing up on the ladder on YouTube, and it's, your fans are very, your fans could be some nice ones out there, some fans are just, but,
It's just, you gotta know how to handle it.
Yeah, just how to,
trust me, you gotta learn control.
I mean, how do you control your fans, or how do you just, like, manage all the comments, and then all the feed messages, and, you know.
Well, I mean, one thing I gotta say is that you need help. Like, this is something that you cannot do by yourself when it comes to handling fans and stuff like that. Usually, like, I can easily take care of the moments on YouTube, like, when it comes to the comments and stuff like that. One of the best apps that I've gotten, like, one of the best things that YouTube has actually released is this app called YouTube Studios, where you can pretty much manage your YouTube account on your phone, and that actually helps out. Like, whenever there's any like really stupid or like mean-spirited, hateful, spiteful comments, like, I would just go and delete them. So that's actually pretty easy to manage. But, like, even nowadays, like, I often would get a lot of comments, so, like, it's starting to become less and less that I read the that I would read comments. I remember there was a time when, like, I would always read each individual comment, but, like, now I'm starting to do it a bit less. Like, I don't read all of them, but, you know, like, it's actually pretty good for my health that, like, I don't read all the comments.
Yeah.
Because, like, you know how the internet would be.
Oh, yeah, the internet is the internet, of course.
Yeah, but, like, I know how to manage it by myself. But then, like, when it would come to social media, like, I actually do have an Animat fan club, which mm-hmm. is actually done, which that is another thing done for fans by fans, but mm-hmm. I don't really take control of it. That's actually done by other people.
Yep.
And they are the ones who are pretty much handling the situation. But, like, I do have a bit of a say. Like, whenever things get hectic in there, like, I would put in my input, but I do leave it to the hands of people who I absolutely trust. They know what to do and they know how to handle the situation. So, I pretty much leave it in their hands to go and keep everything under control. But, yeah, in terms of the fan base, like, I know, like, sometimes there are moments when, like, some people can comment something that's absolutely stupid, or the way that they're handling a situation, they can be very immature, like, especially when I would say something regarding an animated film that they would disagree with. Often, like, it's not, like, oh boy, sometimes it can get really out of hand, and like a lot of people really want to make a mountain out of a molehill. So like as long as you keep yourself calm and cool, it's always nice. So yeah, I know how to handle the comments section, and I know how to handle the fan base. And but at the same time, it's great to have help at the same time, and I'm really grateful for them. Like, they know who they are when listening to this, so guys, I just want to say thank you so much. But yeah, I'm still very grateful of my fans, though. They are still great people overall. I mean, with like most of the time, the thing is, even though like yes, negative comments do come, but often the thing is, the grand majority of comments I get, like, they're often overwhelmingly positive. They all enjoy my videos, and I mean, with the stuff they send me on What's in the Box, I am eternally grateful. So, like, my fans are absolutely wonderful.
Yeah, very wonderful indeed. Expect a little package from me in there for
Oh
your.
boy. I don't know if I actually got that yet, but I better check in my PO box soon.
Yeah, you better check pretty soon, 'cause I sent you a pretty nice gift.
Yay.
Wink, wink, nudge, nudge. Okay, what is the worst anime movie you have ever seen and/or reviewed?
Oh, it would hands down be Where the Dead Go to Die. I mean, like, I've seen plenty of bad ones, but with Where the Dead Go to Die, my God, it's the kind of movie that how the heck did it even exist? It was legitimately something that felt like it got plucked out of the it, like in the deep web. The thing is, there's no the like as a movie in itself, forget like the shock value and stuff like that. There's no story whatsoever. Like, it's kind of this horror anthology, like a horror anthology film, but there's no story whatsoever. Like, they try to set up characters, and then you have this character, like this dog named Labby would come in, and then all you get is just a series of messed up in imagery and shock value. The animation, apparently, the guy who made it, Jimmy Screamaclaws, he apparently, like, he had no experience in animation, and he did this all by himself, and my God, does it actually show, because this barely looks even finished. This shouldn't even be considered like th this wouldn't even be considered like the pre-alpha, or like this wouldn't even be considered like storyboarding for the 3D. It's just it oh my God, it's barely even finished. It's barely even animation, my God. But the characters, they're absolutely horrifying. It's just filled with some of the worst human beings that you can ever imagine. Or that, or even the stupidest ones, like freaking Tommy. And then, like, you got the weird guy with the metal legs. Like, you remember that scene somehow? Like, this guy with metal legs, he asked a hooker to lubricate his metal legs, and somehow that's like masturbating or something?
Yes. Oh
Oh
my
yeah, and
God.
then you also got the dog from hell, Labby. Then after that, like you got oh the pedophile that pedophile hillbilly guy, like that's just messed up. There's nothing in this movie that absolutely works. And my God, it's just how. I mean, like with all due respect, the only good thing that I could say is that at the very least, it is done through the heart. I know Jimmy, and he made the movie because it was a bit of a passion project of him. Like, you could tell, like, the dude has the spirit of a filmmaker, where, like, in a way, Jimmy is a lot like Tommy Wiseau, where, like, his passion and his motivation to make movies are a lot stronger than the films he actually make. And I have actually seen his second film, When Blackbirds Fly. That one is a lot better. Like, that one is a legitimate movie. That one is actually good, and even the like there isn't much disturbing imagery, and like it's actually not disturbing because I don't even know what was going on. Like, you can tell he is at least improving his craft,
Yeah, he is.
but there are so many moments in which, like, it looks like his animation software is completely glitching, and he's just there like, yeah, let's put that in. Yeah, that'll work. Okay, it's just. Like, I don't even understand what is going on. The only moment that I know is this, like, Labby-like character that is a crow. He speaks British, and it's like, I remember somehow he's convincing a guy to have sex with his wife. And it's like, go on, go do it in the box. Ah, yes, you sure like it there, lad. Ah, yes, absolutely beautiful there. But yeah, like, I have to hands down go Where the Dead Go to Die. If not that, then the answer is Food Fight.
Yeah. Because after that review came out, there was this, like, kind of misunderstanding between Jimmy and you for a while, where it's like, there was like this big fiasco in the anime fan club, and then his fans were attacking you, and it was like calling you names. It was like this, this big controversy going on. I was like, whoa, it was like, got out of hand fast.
Yes. It got so out of hand. But the thing is that this is not his first rodeo, actually, because they've been through this before. A few months before my review, there was actually, well, two cases, actually. Before my review, there was the one by Mr. Enter, and there was the one by D. Amanda Hagen.
Yes.
The one by D. Amanda Hagen, that one was fine.
Yeah.
But then was the Mr. Enter one that really got sour. And mm-hmm. I don't know Mr. Enter. I don't know about his relationship with Jimmy right now, if they settled it or something like that. But, like, I've heard that one was definitely not handled well as also. But, yeah, the controversy that happened afterwards, man, it was honestly a nightmare. Down to the point that, like, I couldn't, like, I remember during that day, I couldn't sleep.
Mm-hmm.
Like, oh my god, it was just horrible. But I am so glad that, like I've had help from, like, you helped me out. It, you played a
that,
big role
that day,
trying
yeah.
to help solve the case with Jimmy.
Yeah, that was a
and
big thing
And then there was also
me.
The case with, like, I also had my help, other friends to help me out psychologically and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And even afterwards, like, I had a chat with Jimmy himself, and mm-hmm. everything was going fine from there. So,
yeah,
overall... it turned out fine, so, like, we all ended up happy, and,
yep.
you know, the weird thing is that even, like, even Jimmy ended up liking the review, actually.
Mm-hmm.
He actually enjoyed it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That was the shocking part. So, like, I would say, honestly, right now, I'm actually pretty excited that one day if I would actually pick out When Blackbirds Fly. That, like, I actually want to see that movie again so I could actually understand it a bit more. Because I can see there is a movie there, but it's just like, I gotta understand what the fridge is even going
on. God.
I gotta pass through the glitches.
Animat's analysis of When Blackbirds Fly. Oh god, analyze on a Jimmy Screamer Claus film. Yeah.
At least the one thing that I can reassure is that When Blackbirds Fly is not a bad film. So I have to make a huge apology to Jimmy that I'm sorry, but When Blackbirds Fly is not the second worst animated film ever made.
Yeah, I mean, we'll all be waiting for that review eventually when it comes out, whenever.
It'll come out. That was a life-changing moment, but if anything, that event did make me feel stronger
mm-hmm.
because, like, I've been through the worst of what the internet offered
yep.
me. So, like, any other, like, negative complaints, like, even afterwards, there was a huge controversy when I released, not a huge controversy, but people got mad at me when I released my review of Ratchet & Clank, because they felt like, because, like, so many, like, it was just the Ratchet & Clank fans that were so negative about this movie, and they felt that I was absolutely prejudiced about not just the film, but the whole franchise in general, and I was just there like, oh, shut the fridge up. Because I was expecting it.
I was kind of there, yeah. I was kind of in the same boat when I was watching. I was like, you're talking about the movie, right? Not just the franchise.
No. Well, no, because the thing is, I never played the games.
Exactly.
And, like, because the thing is, if you walked out of watching that, I would have no interest whatsoever in playing the games. Because the thing is that, like, it's like what many fans actually said. This is a horrible, horrible misrepresentation of the games.
Yeah,
and
is.
That's what it does.
Yeah.
Like, after I came out of it, I don't want to play any of the games. If this is the quality that I get in the feature films, I don't even want to know about the games.
Yeah, so... you grew.
So don't blame me, blame the movie! That's the one that freaking sucks!
Yep, you grow as a person, you learn a lot of things from these experiences.
Yeah, you pretty much just end up being stronger and, like... Well, like, whenever when people get mad at your videos, it's just freaking petty complaints. I don't freaking care.
Yeah. What am I thinking? There was some... How did you get associated with Filmbook?
With Filmbook? Ah, yes. Well, funny enough, I remember I was pretty much... the funny thing is, I was actually job searching to become a legitimate film critic. Like, to be a real film critic. To go out and... actually get press screenings to go out and do reviews, because that was a mission that I've wanted to do for a long time, to really help my not just me, but also my channel as well. I wanted to go and improve that by getting press screenings, so that with my review with my reviews I can go and actually make some pretty good, so that I can release my reviews early. So at least it'll be like a win-win situation. And then, I guess I found this Craigslist ad where they wanted to find critics and writers. And I decided to apply in because, like, I want to tell them I want to be a film critic. And they decided to bring me in, but they asked me to do a lot more jobs than I expected, because not only do they want me to be a film critic, but they also wanted me to be a film journalist as well. So, like, we did do a bit of the training, but they realized that I'm not necessarily suited for the writing. But they know that I have something. They know that I have the motivation. They know that I have, like, they know that I have an audience as well. But they can see that I have, that I can do something good for them. So what ended up happening is that instead of doing writing, I ended up making videos for them, and I ended up doing podcasts. So... what ended up happening is that we developed Movie News Weekly, where every week I would tell them, I would go and report 10 different movie news stories. And then what ended up happening afterwards is the animation podcast, where I would just talk about the podcast. But instead of just reporting the news like Movie News Weekly, where it's more straightforward, with the animation podcast, I'm more free to talk about whatever comes out of my head. And that was actually a lot of fun to do. So that is on top of doing reviews. But also, another job that I would do on Filmbook, and this is something that I really like doing, is actually doing Blu-ray reviews, where they would legitimately send me Blu-rays to go and review. And we actually have a lot more luck there. And what's actually very interesting is that even though we don't get a lot of them, the one company that seems to be very generous in terms of helping us with Blu-ray reviews is Disney. Because other than Norm of the North, which is probably the most popular Blu-ray review I've done, I actually did reviews for Toy Story That Time Forgot, The Good Dinosaur, and recently I did a review of the 2016 Jungle Book. So yeah, that's pretty much how... It ended up becoming that. So, but other than that, things are going great with Filmbook, and we're pretty much helping each other to pretty much grow. And I do hope one day that Filmbook does grow to be pretty legitimate, to grow pretty much big to the point that even IMDb would notice, where they would report, they would mention our news stories, or even. What else? It would grow big to the point that, like, even that could actually be a job where they could pay me. That would be a real good dream.
That's cool. You're just climbing up that ladder. You know, gotta be that film critic, though. You never know.
Yeah. Like, I am hoping that with Filmbook that I could be, like, a real, like, you know, I'm kind of like Pinocchio in a way, where, like, I'm hoping with Filmbook I could be a real film critic. And also, real to the point that I can, like, technically I am a real film critic, but, like, real to the point that I can go and get press screenings to do reviews and stuff like that. And on top of that, with all the other elements, like doing the animation podcast, that is definitely fantastic. And also doing the Blu-ray reviews, that's also great as well.
Yeah. The other thing I'm kind of curious about, I don't know if you're involved with this too, or if Filmblock even offers this, but most companies are, it's press basically, so they would have press screenings and they would do interviews with the stars. So would you be interested in doing like press screenings and actually going, have your badge and talk to the people who made the movie and interview them for Filmbook?
Honestly, not real. Honestly, like I don't know. I don't know if I would be suited for that. Like I'm more of I like my specialty is more for being a film critic. I've actually done stuff like that before, believe it or not. Back in the days with if you may remember the dreaded website PME,
Oh,
I
God.
actually yeah, that heaping they still owe me like $2,000, by the way.
Oh, Jesus.
The like I remember I actually used to work like as a cameraman, and we actually did a lot of interviews. And this was actually a job that they actually paid me, but I did a lot of interviews with many of the like with some of the celebrities that came to our local film festival. And we had big stars. We actually like the biggest one that we've got was we did an interview with Nick Frost and Edgar Wright because it was the North American premiere, or at least the Canadian premiere of The World's End.
Okay, I remember that actually. I'm thinking back now. Yeah, oh God.
Yeah, and like we've done other interviews, like we did other small filmmakers, but another one that we did that was actually really interesting is that we interviewed Don Mancini, the creator of the Chucky franchise.
Oh.
Oh, that oh, and it just came on to me. Like another horror icon we did is also we did Kane Hodder, the most prolific actor who did Jason, and we also interviewed Lloyd Kaufman of Troma Films. Because I think like he was doing like he was premiering Return to Nuke 'Em High, and we were pretty much interviewing him, and like it kind of gave me a newfound respect to show like how serious they are in working on their craft. Like you could tell that they have serious they like the best way to put it is that like even though like it's like the movies they make is goofy, but they have serious passion.
And everybody has passion for anything. You have passion for what you do. They have passion for making films, so it's all good overall.
Oh yeah.
What advice do you have for anybody who's willing to, or who's gonna make videos on YouTube or become like a film reviewer or any kind of reviewer in general?
Like a review, like if they want to jump into making videos.
Yeah, making videos and maybe being a reviewer on YouTube.
Yeah. My biggest advice would probably be that if you want to jump into this, do some like whatever you're gonna do, whatever you want to talk about, make sure that it's something that you love. Don't go for anything that's like really popular. Like, don't do a series of videos about Five Nights at Freddy's if you're not interested in Five Nights at Freddy's or if you've never even played the freaking games. Like, don't go and do like what's popular. Do something that you absolutely love. Like for me, I absolutely love animation and I love the Muppets, so I talk about that. So like do it it's more for like talk about something that you absolutely are passionate about, something that you love, so that the motivation would actually work by itself. Do something to the point that you love doing so much that you want to go and make more, that you want to make these videos as much for yourself as it is for your viewers. So that would be my advice from there. Like go into a subject in which you are truly passionate about, that you really do care. And from there, not only is it going to be good for your videos, but it's also going to be good for yourself because throughout the process, you're going to be learning about who you really are. Like it's as much of a journey about making videos as much as it is a journey of self-identity.
Choice words, choice words. Any future videos, projects you're working on now?
Currently, I'm actually doing a series of Patreon requests. Like I said, some of them are going to be anime related. I am continuing a lot more of the animation. I'm continuing a lot more of animation lookback Looney Tunes. So I'm pretty much trying to go out and try to get them released weekly. So that process is going very well. It's going fine, and it's coming out beautifully. And on top of that, I am currently working on a top 10, in which I will say that the subject itself is something that I've always wanted to see. The last top 10 that I've done, the top 10 worst animated sequels, is something that I know that the people would want. This is a top 10 in which I would love to see myself. This is not a personal top 10, like my top 10 personal favorite whatever, or like what do I think is this or that. This is pretty much a top, like a subject that is more close to my heart, something that I like, a subject that I am actually passionate about. So I am currently working on that as well.
I'm trying to think what that could be, but yeah,
you're... Oh no, you're not. You ain't gonna guess it. Oh, trust me, you're gonna be pretty. No, I don't think anybody's gonna guess it. You're gonna be pretty surprised what it is. Like, I don't think it's... I don't know if it's a subject in which, like, it's going to rank up all the views or stuff like that, but it's going to be pretty interesting. No, I promise you that.
No, besides, you're not making... You're not... I mean, are you in for the views in general on YouTube? Or are you just...
Oh, no.
No, because well, it's...
No. The thing... Well, I mean, like the stuff like the views and, like, the things with views and money and all that kind of stuff, like... Like, it can play a factor, but it's not the main reason. I mean,
That's what I thought.
You know, when I did my top 10 worst animated sequels, it's not my first choice to do, it's not necessarily my first choice to make a top 10, but I know that is going to be a subject in which a lot of people would want to see. I know it's going to bring in a lot of views. But when I, like, while I was making it, I try to make sure to make it the best that I can. But no, I don't do it for the views is not like priority number one. Well, I would, trust me, if views are top priority, I would just be making top 10 lists.
And
trust me, if you want to find a channel, like if you want to find YouTube channels who only care about views, look at the ones that only do top 10s or like top lists.
Yeah, it's the most common thing to do on YouTube. A lot of things that ranked in the... How far are you in the Muppet Vlogs, by the way?
In the Muppet Vlogs, I am more than halfway onto season 3. And then I'm going to be moving forward. Yes, and I can absolutely confirm that, like, if I can, I will be moving forward to season 4 and season 5. I know there aren't any DVDs, but I got backup. I know how to get them.
Good.
I have my personal ways. Don't worry.
No. Yeah.
And it's thanks to the help of my past.
What is your favorite episode of the Muppet Show so far?
Of the Muppet Show, so far, that is actually a very good very good. I don't know if I like. I never really thought of my personal favorite. But there's a lot of really good ones that have passed so far. Oh my god. Like the Elton John one is great. Vincent Price, Alice Cooper, Liberace. It's definitely a lot of fun. The John Cleese one is great. Oh, I love the John Cleese one. I'm trying to think. The Harry Belafonte one is actually really nice. And I actually passed through, just recently, I did a really good one with Leslie Uggams and Big Bird. That one was actually really good. But other than that, Harvey Korman is actually really nice. That one is actually really funny. There's also the Edgar Wright and Charlie McCarthy one. And yeah, that's pretty much the ones that I can think on top of my head.
That kind of leads into the... Okay, babe, I'm going to ask this, but... How did you come up with the your talking penis?
Oh my god. That thing. Well, it actually just began as a joke in it began as a gag in the top 10 best animated sequels. It was like when I was talking about Ghost in the Shell, like there was like the movie literally starts out where you see Makoto just literally rips off her shirt and she's completely naked, and then like it just starts out like, yo man, did you just see what I just see? Quite you. So I just started off from there, but then eventually down the road, I decided to pick him up again. It was, I think the other time that I brought him back was what was it? The review of The Legend of the Titanic, because in that movie, oh my God, the amount of cleavage that was in there. Like, trust me, boobs are almost coming off, I swear to God. Like, technically, you can even argue in the other animated Titanic film, Titanic: The Legend Goes On, you actually like there's actually some pretty big there's some pretty good boobage there as well. And I decided to bring him back there too. And the most recent one that I've done was actually in an episode of the Muppet Vlog, and that was with the Raquel Welch episode. That's another great one, by the way. But oh my God, that was hot. You would not expect that amount of sexiness on the Muppet Show. I remember I was talking with Mike about the Raquel Welch episode, and like he showed me a clip with Raquel Welch, and I showed him it was the dance scene where Raquel Welch was with the spider. It's like, check that out. And you were just shocked by how revealing she was. Like, it was legit. It was legit, like, arguably more revealing than how she was in 50 million years BC.
Yeah, way more revealing than 100 million BC.
And that was for the Muppet Show, dude. Keep in
Yeah,
mind.
it's for the Muppet Show. I'm just like, but now you got a thing for Raquel Welch. Boing.
Oh my God, yeah, really. Even nowadays, she's hot. It's crazy.
Yeah, I just remember that. I was like, boing! It's like, oh, shit. Any final thoughts? Anything you want to say to your fans, to your audience? They want you to know.
Well, anything that all I could say is just, you guys have been very supportive since the very beginning. I just want to say thank you guys so much, and I promise you guys, there's going to be plenty of more great videos to come. So just tune in, and yeah, I got like, don't forget, there's also my, I guess now is a good time to plug in my social media stuff. So I got Facebook. I got Twitter, and I also got Patreon if you wanna, if you wanna go on that extra mile to support my work and you wanna get some awesome rewards on the side, it's all in there. So, yeah.
Yeah.
That's it.
This has been Cinema Talk with Mike Mixtape. Thanks for Animatic for doing this interview, and next time's gonna be a surprise for you guys, so thanks for listening and watching, and
Surprise?
It's a surprise, because I don't even know.
You don't even know. What a surprise!
Spoiler alert. Thanks for watching. Have a nice night.
And see you later, dudes. That is if we know what's even going on in this later. Already, it just sounds like a bad date, I swear. Oh, I got. Don't worry, honey. I got a surprise for you. Oh, God, I gotta organize something quick. Hello, can you make reservations now?